I'm so curious what you think about this Bret Taylor news. He's now co-CEO with Mark Benioff. Does this make sense to you?
It's great to be on Bloomberg Technology, Emily. Thanks for having me. I think it's great for Salesforce, and it's great for Bret, and it's great for Mark. You get a world-class technologist and product person in Bret, and we all know what Mark is. He's legendary in terms of leading the company and vision and evangelizing all the latest, greatest technology. It's a killer combination, and I think as Salesforce thinks about what it's going to do in the decade ahead, as it's going to continue its product evolution and its architecture, it's amazing to have Bret in that seat.
Let's not forget, Salesforce had a co-CEO before, Keith Block. It didn't work out. Why do you think chances are better this time? And do you think this paves the way for Benioff to eventually make an exit?
I think Mark has said this as well. I can't imagine Salesforce without Mark. He created the company. He's grown it. He'll be there forever. And I wouldn't say it didn't work out with Keith. I mean, they were pretty successful with Keith in that seat. So I think this is just the next evolution of it. When you look at the company, the scale they're operating at, the latest quarter was over $6 billion in revenue. They have a lot of sales to do. They have a lot of marketing. They have a lot of positioning. They have a lot of product and technology to build. And having Bret and Mark in the CEO seats is an amazing combination to do that.
Okay, but the Keith Block thing didn't last more than a couple of years. We'll see how long this one lasts. I hear you. We are seeing a wave of departures from MuleSoft. There's a lot of talk about whether MuleSoft can continue to deliver on the numbers that it's seen in past years. What do you make of that? Is that a red flag?
I think there's in organizations that are growing and dynamic and companies are coming together, there's always going to be change. But I like to zoom back and look at the landscape, what's going on. And this is why broadly, not just Salesforce or not just Twitter, this is broadly speaking why there are more technical CEOs being promoted into that job. And that's because in every industry, every company has to think about being a technology company and has to be a technology company. If you're the CEO of GM or Toyota, you're not competing as much with each other and other auto companies, you're competing with Tesla. If you're the CEO of any e-commerce company or any retail company, you're competing with the e-commerce leaders like Amazon, and those are led by technologists. And I think that as the world moves more into this technology world we're all living through, having a technologist at the helm is a huge, huge asset. We're seeing it not in the companies we're talking about, but in the companies that we serve as customers of Okta. It's a strong trend I see continuing.
Totally understand why having those technical skills can be hugely beneficial. CEOs are also having to deal with major regulatory issues, global regulatory issues. Jack Dorsey is having to decide free speech issues, whether or not to kick the president off the platform. So I wonder if it can be at all a disadvantage not to have that kind of global view of a business.
The thing about the job is that you have to have many, many perspectives and you have to have many, many viewpoints. I think maybe in the past, one of the raps on technologists was that they were too narrow. They saw technology only and everything else was at the expense of technology. But all these people we're talking about being promoted into these jobs have a broad perspective on the different challenges and the different opportunities. And they're also good at building teams. Back to Mark and Bret, it's kind of the ultimate team building. Elevate someone to the CEO level and share that in terms of teamwork. There's strong teams behind these organizations, and you have to balance off a tech-centric world with all these broad issues you're talking about. And hopefully you get more decisions right than you get wrong. That's the best we can hope for.
Well, speaking of balance, Bret Taylor not only was promoted to co-CEO 2 days earlier, he was promoted to chair of the Twitter board. Isn't that a lot for one person if we're talking about taking things away, like Jack Dorsey not being CEO of two companies in just one? Isn't that a lot for Bret to handle?
He's a talented guy, and I think he can probably help each organization bringing the perspective of the other one, because one of the things you're trying to do on a board is build a board of diversity in terms of lots of different things, one of them being thought and experience. And I think when you think about building out a board, not only from the enterprise side, but from the social media experience side and the rest of the people on the board that can bring various viewpoints there, it's a strong board as well.
Meantime, Okta is, of course, you know, one of the biggest players in enterprise and identity security. Curious what's on your mind for 2022. Where do you think the biggest threats are?
Well, along with the rise of technology, we've talked about this trend and how it's never been more of a board level conversation and a CEO level conversation as to how companies are going to build new products, how they're going to take their existing products and move them online and make them more compelling in this competitive techno-centric age. Along with that comes security. So with the rising rewards that you can get from automating things and connecting them from a technical perspective, the bigger the risks are for security. So there's always a balance there. And I think another benefit of having technologists in the boardroom and in the top executive chairs is they have a perspective on some of the, not only the upsides of this technology, but the risks involved, because it's always about balancing. It's about doing the most with the assets at your disposal without exposing yourself to undue risk and managing that risk when it does arise.
So is ransomware, for example, still going to be as big a threat as it was in 2021 or bigger?
It's a rising threat. So 2021 has been a marquee year for ransomware, and we expect that to continue. And that's mostly because companies have so much at stake online. They have so much at stake building these big businesses, building these big opportunities, connecting with their customers, with their supply chain, and that opens up risk. So companies at the same time are taking mitigation steps, and we as an industry are working hard to make sure that risk is managed and companies don't run into these unforeseen issues.